Welcome to Re'e Yisrael, which means in English, Behold, O Israel, the Bible-teaching television ministry of Congregation Shema Yisrael. Shema Yisrael is a Messianic Jewish congregation in Rochester, New York. Be sure to get out your Bible and a notebook and follow along with this week's lesson from the Scriptures. I want to take a moment and review last week's message, because this week turned into part two of last week's message, and I thank Keith for kind of reviewing it as we started out, but not everybody was here, so do it again. But it's very important to us all how God makes us feel, right? Joy, peace, security, acceptance. And it is wonderful that you and I experience these positive feelings from him. Everybody agree? Yes. But we learned from the Bible last week that God has feelings too, emotions, and they're positive and negative. If you truly love him, you will care about his feelings and want to contribute to his positive feelings and avoid causing him negative feelings. And we understand that our loving God, us loving our God is very high priority to him. How do we know that? We always, and every congregation all around the world, always starts their service with a command from God. You know what command I'm talking about and what we call it? Not the Shema, but the V'ahavta. V'ahavta in Hebrew means, and the, you shall love. And you shall love. So it's Deuteronomy chapter 6. In verse 5, love Adonai, the Lord your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And I don't see any slides up there yet. There they go. Okay. So the Holy Spirit directed me to take the same theme yesterday of having love for God, but take it in a different direction today. And it came out of some words that popped out of my mouth in the message last week that weren't in my notes. It just came out, came to me as I was speaking. I spoke of the difference between lust and love. And lust was probably not the right word to use because it's so associated with sex, illicit sex especially. So today I'm going to call it a kind of love and deeper love. So it's kind of like love and deeper love, the difference between them. And love, not the deeper love, and I don't want to call it shallow, because love is love. Love is a wonderful thing. It's what you feel towards someone when you love him or her because she or he has had a positive effect on you. And that effect may be physical. It may be emotional. It may be intellectual. It may be financial. And so this is kind of the first stage of love. So an example of this would be you love your doctor who has helped you through a serious disease. And that's great. But there's also a greater love, a deeper love. And that is when you love a person because they've had a positive effect on you, same thing. And you love, your love for him or her now includes concern for their welfare. For example, again, you love your doctor and now you're concerned about his personal life, his emotions, his health, how he's doing. So in John chapter 15, the Lord tells us about what I believe is this greater love, because that's what he calls it. In verse 13, he says, no one has greater love than a person who lays down his life for his friends. So this greater love also means being willing to sacrifice, even suffer. Give whatever you can for the well-being of the beloved person. So everybody follow that so far? So we're going to apply this understanding about love and deeper love to your relationship with God. We'll start out in Romans 5 in verse 8. But God demonstrates his own love for us in that the Messiah died on our behalf while we were still sinners. So before you or I loved God, we were sinners, and he loved us. And like the doctor, he enabled you to recover from an eternally fatal condition, sin. So the first stage of love for God, now you love him because of what he did for you. You praise him. You give him glory. You tell him you love him. And since he first loved you, and I'm sure this is all of your experience, he has continued to help you deal with the trials of life. Sickness, provision, grief, fear. And that leads to this second stage of love, greater love, or deeper love. So your love, and this is where we got to last week, now includes caring about his well-being, just like you care about the doctor, right? Now, right away, people's lights go off or they shut down or whatever, because you don't usually think about God's well-being as something of concern to you, right? But that was kind of the revelation of last week. We learned that God has positive and negative feelings. That's how you affect his well-being. Negative feelings, anger, frustration, remorse, which are the feelings that we identify God has, those are not good. So we're saying here that you do affect God's well-being in the sense of his feelings. And your deeper love for him makes you want to contribute to his positive feelings. What are some of his positive feelings? Joy, obviously. Satisfaction. Victory. And not contribute to his negative feelings, like anger and grief and frustration. So also, this stage of love, this deeper love, means you are willing to sacrifice, even suffer, and give whatever you can for the well-being of your beloved, in this case, your Heavenly Father. So what can you give for his well-being that's like a sacrifice? Well, you can sacrifice your desires in order to obey his commands or follow the guidance of his Spirit. How many have had to do that at some point in your life? Right. So deeper love is a greater love. It's a more mature love. And God wants you to love him with all your heart, mind, and strength. So what do you think? Does he want greater love from us? Yeah, that's why he described it that way. All your heart, all your mind, all your strength. He wants your love to grow to a love for him that cares about him, cares about his feelings, a love that wants to bring him joy, a love that wants to avoid causing him grief or anger, and a love that causes you to sacrifice your own desires to bring him that joy, to bring him satisfaction, a deeper love. So just let's step back a little bit and say, why would you love someone with this depth of love? And as I thought about this, there's really no logical reason for this. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, John wrote, God is love. So my understanding is that God put love into this world, and it is this deeper, greater love that he put here. He puts it in human hearts, this deeper love, and we do see it in many ways in human hearts. The deep love of a parent for their child, that's greater love. A parent would sacrifice for the child, cares about the child. A child for their parent can be deep love. A person for their siblings, brothers and sisters, can be deep love. A love of one spouse for another can be deep, greater love. That love makes you want the person you love to be blessed, to have positive feelings, experience positive things, even if it costs you something on the way. So what is so wonderful about this is that living out this kind of love for God will greatly bless you. You will experience his love, his joy, his peace, his provision, his protection. It will greatly bless you. So let's just look at some examples here and consider romantic love. As far as my observations and my experience, it usually starts out at that first stage. Not necessarily physical right away. That other person makes you feel important, beautiful, happy, secure, protected. Makes you proud to be with him or her. You have fun together. Maybe that person fulfills your dreams of what a spouse should be like. And of course, physically, which is what we usually think of as lust, that person arouses and hopefully after marriage, eventually satisfies your sexual desires and your desire to have a family. But romantic love must turn into deeper love for a marriage to succeed. And Rabbi Shaul speaks about this in Ephesians in his exhortation to husbands. As for husbands, love your wives just as the Messiah loved the Messianic community, indeed gave himself up on its behalf. So what he's seeing here, and it can be also translated to wives, is husbands and wives must care more about the feelings of their spouse than about their own well-being or feelings, and must be willing to sacrifice their own desires to bring joy, satisfaction, peace, security to their spouse. So how does your relationship with another person grow from love to deeper love? Well, in Romans chapter 5, the Lord gives us some instruction. God's love for us has already been poured out into our hearts through the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. So God puts that love in us. He puts it into our hearts, especially when we are followers of Him. And He makes you want your beloved to experience positive things, to be blessed. Now, sometimes this change happens due to gratitude, because that other person has shown you love. For example, I have eternal gratitude for Diane. Diane led me to the Lord. She was instrumental in that. She prayed me into the kingdom, and her example led me to the Lord, and it was her love. And so whenever I'm feeling like I'm not happy about Diane about something, it comes back to me. Look at what she did for me, and that brings back that deeper love. I owe her my life. I owe her my salvation. I owe her my eternal life. So how can I not love her, right? I didn't expect applause. I expected a smile from Diane. So how do you know what makes that other person in terms of relationships have those positive feelings? Well, it's pretty easy. Observation. What makes them smile? What makes them laugh? What makes them express gratitude? What makes them have peace? And if you want to go beyond that, you can ask. You might be surprised what you hear. You can listen for clues. And I've recommended this to just about everybody I've done premarital counseling or marital counseling. Read the book called The Five Love Languages by Gary Chapman. The five love languages are spending time together, giving gifts, touch, affirming words, and acts of service. There are probably some more, but that when you read that and you find out what your beloved's languages are, then you know how to show them love. So here's a challenging question for all of you, even out there, and me. This is a challenging question to me. Has your relationship with God grown into that deeper, greater love? Is it your great desire to make Him experience positive feelings, to make Him feel blessed? That's a challenging question. At least it was for me. And after last week's message, where that was the point of it, all week long, I was just kind of checking myself and, you know, okay, am I thinking about how this affects the Lord? Am I thinking about, is this something that makes Him joyful, or is this something that makes Him angry? So how do you tell if your love of God is deeper? So I was praying about what it's like to be a follower of Yeshua, to love the Lord, but not have that deeper love. And you can listen to these and see if any of these you can identify with. You obey because of gratitude for what He has done for you, and because your obedience will bring you blessings, or you fear punishment. You pray, but mostly you pray for yourself, your needs, your loved ones' needs. You serve, and when you serve, your goal is to do it with excellence. You worship, but when you worship, your main objective is to feel good, to feel good about yourself, to lift yourself out of depression or whatever. You study His word to gain more understanding of the world, of life. When you help those in need, why do you do that? Well, you know, it feels good to help other people. Always feels good. What about sharing your faith with unbelievers? Well, you probably don't do much of that, because that requires a risk. risking opposition, rejection, even being mocked or persecution. And what I found is that it's hard to overcome those obstacles unless your motivation is the deeper love motivation to bring joy to the Father. So, now that I've kind of described one level of love, if you love God with deeper love, how would it change your life? And we're going to go through this and look at how it would change your life, but also how do you show that love for God? How do you show that deeper love for God? How would it change your obedience, your prayer, your serving, your worship, your study of God's word, your ability to help the needy, your witnessing? With deeper love, your motivation is always to bring the Father joy, bring him satisfaction, bring him victory. And that goes across all areas of your life. That's my main motivation, to bring the Father joy. So let's look first at how deeper love for God affects all these areas of life and what you can do to bring joy to your Father's heart. We'll start with obedience. John 14, verse 15 says, "If you love me, you'll keep my commands." Whoa, that's pretty clear. And by the way, the love word there in the Greek is agape. It's the selfless love. So obedience is a sign that you love him. And keeping his commandments is required of those who love him. But obedience to the letter of the law does not bring God joy, because it does not involve a relationship with him. It's just legalism. I've got these rules. I'll obey these rules. Here's the kind of obedience that brings the Father joy. First is obedience to the spirit of his written word rather than the letter. In John 14, 26, Yeshua tells us this, "But the counselor, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything. That is, he will remind you of everything I have said to you." And that word counselor in the Greek is the word parakletos. And if you go look it up, it actually means an attorney. An attorney. A personal attorney. So what has that got to do with it? The Holy Spirit is your parakletos, your personal attorney who guides you in understanding and obeying God's laws. And I always think of the mafia movies. You know, there's the Godfather, right? But then there's always the attorney who's like his right-hand man, who teaches him, how does he get around this law and how does he not get caught on this law? And in Italian, consigliere, right? What is it? Consigliere. So it's the same word. You see that? And in fact, we call lawyers counselors. So when you ask and receive from the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, understanding of God's laws and halakhic direction. Halakhic is the Hebrew word meaning is how do we walk out the laws of God? You know, like does one law take priority over another in this situation? And that means you are understanding and obeying the spirit of the law because you're guided by the spirit, not just the letter. That brings joy to your Father's heart because it involves him in the process. And he's always about relationships. The second is obedience to not just the written word, but to the Holy Spirit for direction beyond the written word. Like, what am I supposed to do today? Who am I supposed to call? So let's look a little bit about that. In Romans chapter 8, verse 6, it says, "Having one's mind controlled by the old nature is death. But having one's mind controlled by the Spirit is life and shalom," or peace. Now, my experience has been with this. This is a lifetime process of learning to discern between your own thoughts and the thoughts given by the Holy Spirit. And also mixed in there are thoughts from Satan, from the world, from other people, from reading, from television, from the internet, all kinds of thoughts. Being able to discern what is actually from the Holy Spirit. What is he saying to me? And then the second side of that is having the courage to obey those thoughts from the Holy Spirit, even when they don't make any sense, or even when they require a risk. So one way of hearing from the Holy Spirit is to be in the Spirit. And I did a message on this a few weeks ago, demystifying the idea of being in the Spirit, that it's not just, you know, when you're in a trance of some kind. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10, we have an example written by Yochanan or John. I came to be in the Spirit on the day of the Lord, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. Verse 11, saying, write down what you see on a scroll and send it to the seven messianic communities. So Yochanan was in the Spirit when God revealed visions to him. And what does this mean, to be in the Spirit? Well, it means being focused on hearing the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And when does it happen? Well, worship really helps, but you can worship and not be in the Spirit. Spending time with the Lord in prayer or the Word is, you can be in the Spirit there. But especially listening prayer. We do so much speaking prayer, but listening prayer, being quiet before the Lord and saying, Lord, I want to hear from you. And I'm not saying you're going to hear an audible voice, but you're going to get thoughts. Thoughts are going to come to your mind that, at least for me, I recognize those aren't my thoughts. I never would have thought that. It's too smart. I never would have figured that out. We just had an example of this in our elders meeting Thursday night. We were trying to make a decision, and we all just stopped. Right, elders? We all just stopped, and we prayed for a while. And then somebody started talking, and I said, no, let's go back. We got to go back and pray. We got to go back. And I didn't mean pray out loud and asking him. I meant just shutting up and listening. And then we were quiet for a while, and then all of a sudden, I heard something, and it was so simple, I realized that there was a real reason to make this decision one way and not the other, and that was the Holy Spirit. I hadn't thought of it before, but it was clear. It was clear. So ask the Father to speak to you. Here's a good one. Ask him, what is on his heart today that you want me to do? Is this something you want me to take care of today? Is this something you wanted me to do about my life or to do about somebody else's life? And, very simply, you can ask him, how can I bring you joy today? Anybody here ever prayed that prayer? Good. How can I bring you joy today? So the second area of life that's affected by deeper love is prayer. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 6 says this, don't worry about anything. Anybody here ever worry about anything? Oh, yes. Forgive us, Lord. On the contrary, make your requests known to God by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. So you start your prayer time with praise, but with deeper love, you want to know how God feels about things, about what you're doing. So you pray the Holy Spirit will reveal any sin in your life, anything that you need to change. Maybe it's not abject sin. Maybe it's just you've got your priorities wrong, or you're ignoring something that needs to be taken care of. And you need to humble yourself in repentance. And remember, that's where we got to last week with the joy of the Lord is my strength. It was God's joy because the people had repented. That was their strength. So repentance, humbling yourself, then you can make a request known with thanksgiving. That's a demonstration of trust in God. And you know what? Your trust in him brings him joy. Absolutely. And then seek the leading of the Holy Spirit to guide you in prayer. And he will lead you to pray about your priorities, what you're to do, all those kind of things. And ask the question, are these things pleasing to you, Father? And again, you must learn to listen. You must learn to be quiet and listen. And if you love him with godly love, with deeper love and care about him, you should include in your prayers listening to what is in his heart. Even asking, how are you today, Father? Your goal is to know him better through spending time listening. And I had some interesting experiences this week when I asked him, how are you today, Father? And I found that he's grieving greatly for all the people that are being killed, his people killing each other, his creations killing each other. And then he pointed out that he's been grieving for decades. that people are killing innocent babies. And what came to my mind was, wow, how many wars has God seen happen amongst the people he created, going back to the beginning? Can you imagine how many wars there have been? How many tribal battles? How many state battles? Kingdoms battling, now nations battling. It's been going on through all history. And I got a little depressed about that. Lord, you must be grieving forever. And then he said this. He's also rejoicing because in the midst of the trials of war, many are turning to him for help and are being saved. Many are turning to him for help. Another side of this area of prayer is that when you love God with deeper love, you will love those whom he loves. Okay? If you love somebody, you love the people they love. And who are the people that he loves? Well, here's that most familiar verse in the Bible, John 3:16. For God so loved the world, the people of the world, not the rocks and the trees, that he gave his only and unique son so that everyone who trusts in him may have eternal life instead of being utterly destroyed. So God loves every person in the world. So with deeper love, you will pray for other people whom God loves because you will love those who God loves. And that will bring joy to the Father's heart. Third area of life affected by deeper love is service. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 says this, whatever work you do, put yourself into it as those who are serving not merely other people, but the Lord. Verse 24, remember that as your reward, you will receive the inheritance from the Lord. You are serving, you are slaving for the Lord, for the Messiah. So, how do you serve the Lord when your desire is to bring him joy? Well, to serve God whom you can't see, you must serve people whom you can see. So what it's saying here is to serve other people as if they were the Lord himself. Putting yourself into that serving, how does he say it here? With all your heart. With all your heart. And then another very powerful instruction, Matthew 6:33, which I'm sure you all know, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all those things will be given to you as well. So to bring joy to your Father by serving, your service must advance his kingdom in some way. Now, I'll give an example of what you can do here. You can advance his kingdom, this part of his kingdom, by taking responsibility for some of the work of the ministry here. This part of God's kingdom is in need of your service. Why? Because praise the Lord, after months of many people staying away, people are coming back. And so we need more help because people are coming back. We need more ushers. We need more security guards. We need more nursery workers. We need more Shabbat school teachers. For a while there, we were down to like 10 people. We didn't need any help. Well, we needed the 10 people. But now we need help. We also need more worship leaders. We need camera operators. We need live stream technicians and people working on the projector. Because our goal is to have enough people that people only have to serve like once a month. They don't have to be doing it every week. So let that encourage you to step up. Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, another amazing instruction about serving. In the same way, let your light shine before people so that they may see the good things you do and praise or glorify your Father in heaven. What are the good things that you do? It means helping people in times of need, in times of sickness, grief, lack of resources, rides. You bring joy to the Father when you do this, but you also have to glorify him to bring him joy. Meaning you give God the credit for the good things you do. And, of course, you can testify the good things he's done in your life. If you do something good and don't give God the credit or the glory, you'll get the glory. And that should not be your goal. And that does not bring God joy. Your motivation will be to bring God joy by enabling others to experience God's love coming to them through you. And that brings great joy to the Father. Fourth area of life affected by deeper love is worship. John chapter 4, verse 23 says, "But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when the true worshipers will worship the Father spiritually and truly," or in spirit and in truth, "for these are the kind of people the Father wants worshiping him." So with deeper love, you will want to worship the Father the way he wants to be worshiped, because that's what brings him joy. When people worship him in ways that he does not want them to worship him, a lot of which goes on, that doesn't bring him joy. He wants you to worship him in ways that bring him joy. So what is it? What is it to worship in spirit and truth? Well, in truth, first of all. His word is truth. That's what Yeshua said. So worship in the ways he has commanded us to worship is worshiping in truth. In his written word, like on the Moedim, on the appointed times. Keeping his commands, like keep the Passover. Why? We've mentioned it before. To remember the Exodus. Keep the Feast of Tabernacles or Sukkot. Why? To remember their miraculous survival in the wilderness of our forefathers. So worshiping in truth is something that you can do in, since the Messianic movement has been here, because that wasn't happening before. Worshiping in spirit. Be led by the Holy Spirit in your worship rather than by tradition. There's lots of worship traditions in the world. Some of them are very nice, but what is the Holy Spirit saying? What is the Holy Spirit saying about worship? Fifth area of life affected by deeper love is studying God's word. When you love the Lord deeply and want to bring him joy, you will cherish his word. You'll have it on your heart as you would a letter from someone you dearly loved, a love letter. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 says this. This is Rabbi Shaul or Paul speaking. "I give it all up in order to know him. That is, to know the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings as I am being conformed to his death." When you love the Lord with deeper love, your greatest desire is to know him better. And he's so amazing that there's always more to know about him and about his ways. You'll never run out. You'll never get to where, oh, I know him well enough now. There's always more. And this is actually the reason so many non-Jewish people have gotten involved in Messianic Judaism. They understand that when the Lord lived on the earth in the form of the Messiah, he lived as a Jewish man in a Jewish culture. And that by being involved in Messianic Judaism and learning about the Jewish roots of their faith, they can learn to understand what he experienced. He kept the Passover. He went out in the Sukkah. And by that, you come to know him better. So if that's your desire to know him better, you're in the right place. The sixth area of life affected by deeper love is helping the needy. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17 says, "Learn to do good, seek justice, relieve the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. All these bring joy to the Father's heart." But when I read Isaiah's message on this, I caught something very interesting. You notice it starts out with him saying, learn to do these things. They're not things people do instinctively or naturally. On the contrary, our instincts tell us to look out for number one, for ourselves. So to overcome those instincts, you need the motivation of bringing joy to the Father's heart. I'm going to help this poor person, not because it does me any good, but because it brings joy to the Father's heart. And then Micah chapter 6 and verse 8 says, "He's told you, humanity, what is good and what Adonai is seeking from you, to only to practice justice, to love mercy, and walk humbly with your God." So helping the needy also involves standing up against injustice, which also requires risking opposition, rejection, even persecution. So you need deeper love as the motivation of bringing joy to the Father to overcome those risks. So if you're not aware of it, we have free ministries you can participate in here that will teach you how to do these things. We have a homeless ministry, we have sharing our bread, and we have, you call it pocketbooks still, right, Ava? So see Ava if you want to bring joy to your Heavenly Father in this way. Seventh area of life affected by deeper love is sharing your faith. Back to John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only and unique son, so that everyone who trusts in him may have eternal life instead of being utterly destroyed. So the people of the world who do not trust in Yeshua are headed for what? Utter destruction. That's called hell. Yet they're part of the world. They're part of the people that God loves. So when you love the Father with deeper love, you will also love those he loves, which is all the people of the world. He loved you while you were yet a sinner. You didn't love him. You were in opposition to him, maybe, sacrificing his life for you. So you should love those who don't love him or don't love you, even those who oppose you. And you need the motivation of bringing joy to the Father to share with those who are not now trusting in Yeshua. Because, again, sharing your faith also exposes you to risk. Risk of opposition, risk of rejection, risk of being mocked, risk of being persecuted even. And I found in trying to teach people to go out on the streets, to reach out, there is so much opposition to the enemy, fear of these things, that I believe the only thing that can overcome it is that you will bring the Father great joy at each person you bring into the kingdom. Because they're ones he loves, they're heading for utter destruction, and you bring them into eternal life. You help him do that. So here's some other aspects of life that bring joy to the Father's heart. Isaiah 57, verse 15. For thus says the high and exalted one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in a high and holy place, yet also with a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and receive the heart of the contrite. Humility brings joy to the Father's heart. Now, here's my definition of humility. I believe it's biblical. It means having a realistic understanding of your abilities, not too high and not too low, and a willingness to do the things God calls you to do that you know are beyond your abilities. And a contrite heart that brings joy to the Father, being contrite simply means being quick to repent, being open to being corrected, being open to the Holy Spirit speaking to you about things that you might not want him to speak to you about. Psalm 50, verse 14 says, offer God a sacrifice of thank offerings, then fulfill your vows to Elyon, God Most High. So faithfulness, keeping your promises, is whether to God or to other people, brings joy to the God Father's heart, and breaking them does not bring joy to his heart. It brings anger. John 13, verse 34, I'm giving you a new command, that you keep on loving each other. In the same way that I have loved you, you are also to keep on loving each other. This command is given to Yeshua's followers, those who love him. And he's saying, love each other, that is other followers of Yeshua, the same way Yeshua loves you. That will bring joy to the Father's heart. What is that love like with which Yeshua loves you? Well, we read this verse before. We'll read it again. John 15, 13. No one has greater love than a person who lays down his life for his friends. When we love each other with this depth of love, it brings joy to the Father's heart. And by the way, it doesn't mean committing suicide, laying down your life for your friends. It means laying down your desires, the things that you want, your dreams, laying down the things that are important to you to bless other people because you love them, because you love them. And then the last one here, John 13, 35. Everyone will know that you are my Talmudim or my disciples by the fact that you have love for each other. So this not only brings joy to the Father's heart, but it has a powerful effect on those around us because they identify us as Yeshua's disciples by the fact that we show love to one another, when it can be seen. So why should you love your brothers and sisters in the Lord? Again, if you truly love someone, you must love those that he or she loves. So if you truly love the Lord, you'll love those he loves, And he especially loves those who have come into a relationship with him. So before we end up, let's just take a minute and list, because I don't want to go into them. How can you give God negative feelings? Ready? Anger, frustration, a sense of betrayal. Those are the negative feelings that God might have. And here's the list. Disobedience, idolatry, making something more important to you than God, pride, selfishness, ignorance, lying, fraud, doubt, greed, bitterness, hatred, contention, sexual sins of adultery, fornication, homosexuality, incest, bestiality, all of those, gluttony, abuse, addiction, prejudice, witchcraft, atheism. Did I miss any? Call them out if I missed them. Unforgiveness. Good one. Any other? Okay, it must be a pretty complete list. So those are the things that don't bring joy to the Father's heart. And that should be your motivation to stay away from them if you have deeper love. So let's pray. Lord, forgive us if we have given in to any of that list. Things that anger you, we ask for your forgiveness in the name of Yeshua, and we receive it right now. We receive it that you paid the price for it. You suffered for it. And we pray, and I just want to ask you to make some sign right now, if you can agree with me in a prayer for that you would have deeper love for the Father. So just raise your hand up if you want to love the Father with deeper love. Father, you see the hands. All of these want to love you with that deeper love, which is an unselfish love, which is a giving love. And I pray, we pray for each other. We pray for people out there in live stream world that are raising their hands right now. We pray, Father, that you would deepen our love for you, that it would even go beyond all of our mind, heart, soul, and strength, but it would be deepened in all of those ways. And we thank you, Lord, that you say that you pour out your love in our hearts, so we can't do this. You have to pour out your love in our hearts that we might love you in a greater way. And we pray, Lord, and see if you can agree with this one. May we desire to bring you joy, Lord. May we desire to bring you satisfaction and victory, all of those positive emotions and feeling. And Father, we thank you for sending your Ruach to help us be obedient to your written word. Help us to learn to seek his revelation of the revelation of the Spirit about the spirit of your laws. Help us to learn to follow the guidance of your Ruach every day of our lives. Help us to have the courage to obey when it looks like it's risky or foolish. And Father, may our obedience bring you joy. Teach us, Lord, to pray in a way that brings you joy. Teach us to pray as led by your Spirit, to seek a revelation of sin in our lives, to repent. And here's a big one, Lord. Help us to listen. How many need help listening? I need help listening to the Lord and to people. Help us to listen, Lord. Help us to be able to tell your thought, you in our thoughts from the enemy, from our own thoughts, from other people's thoughts. Lord, give us a desire to know what's on your heart each day and to pray with love for those you love whom we might not even know or whom might have offended us. And help us, Lord, to come to know you better each day. Lord, we want to bring you joy by serving you. So we pray, Lord, that you'd open the door for us to serve you by serving each other. And make it so that, Lord, we can tell when we're seeking first your kingdom, because that's what you want. And remind us, Lord, to give you the glory when we do something commendable. And Father, we thank you for worship. Thank you that we can get together and worship you together today. And we pray, Lord, that our corporate worship and our worship in our own homes would be in the Spirit and in truth. Thank you for your giving us your word. Will you tell us how to worship you in truth? And I just want to thank you, Lord, for living in this time when you have restored the ability to worship you according to your word in the Moedim. Because that did not happen for centuries, Lord. And we can worship you in ways you instructed our forefathers to worship. And may we bring joy to your heart as we do, even as we're looking toward Passover right now, which you instructed. And we could say that you instructed us to remember Purim, Father. And Father, thank you for giving us your word. Lord, I pray that we cherish this as a personal love letter from you. And that we would come to know you better through the study of your word. And Father, we ask you to give us the motivation to overcome that resistance to helping the needy and to sharing our faith, to overcome that fear of rejection, that we would know, Lord, this brings you joy. Every time we spread seed, every time we toss out seed, it brings you joy. And may we toss out good seed, Lord, wherever we go. May we see the joy that you have, like we talked about last week, Lord, of seeing one lost person found. How great that joy is that the shepherd threw a party because one sheep was found. The prodigal father threw a party because the son that was lost was found. And may we share in your joy, Father, as people come into the kingdom. And finally, Lord, help us to bring you joy by walking in humility, with contrite hearts, by being faithful to our promises and vows, and by showing your love to our brothers and sisters, that greater love that lays down your life for those you love. And we thank you, Father, for giving us love in this world. I just think of, Lord, what would this world be like if there was no love? It's pretty bad with love, but imagine what it would be like if there was no love, if there wasn't your love, if there wasn't love that we have for each other. And we pray, Father, for love to prevail, even right now in the crisis that our world is in, with this war going on, Father, that somehow love would break through there as even President Putin watches mothers and children being injured, being killed, running away from their homes being destroyed, just the picture of love there, of the parent protecting the child, would touch even his hard heart, Lord God. And we think of Pharaoh, Lord, where his heart was so hard, and eventually you turned that all around, and we pray that also. And we thank you, Father, that you are the God of love, in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen.
Stay tuned for a short closing message from Rabbi Jim Appel.
Shalom. I'm Messianic Rabbi Jim Appel, and I hope you enjoyed our TV program. It was produced for you by Congregation Shema Yisrael, a Messianic Jewish synagogue. Shema Yisrael is a congregation of Jewish and non-Jewish people who worship the God of Israel while maintaining our Jewish identity and lifestyle, and who believe that Yeshua, whose English name is Jesus, is Israel's promised Messiah. Shema Yisrael's purposes are to proclaim Yeshua as Messiah to Jewish and non-Jewish people and help them connect personally with the God of Israel through worship. We welcome you to join our mishpacha, or family, and connect with your Jewish roots. I'd love to meet you personally at one of our weekly Shabbat services or at one of our special events where people from all backgrounds are welcome. Shalom.
We hope you enjoyed today's teaching. Call our office to request a copy on videotape. If you would like more information about Messianic Judaism or Shema Yisrael, please call us at 585-288-0670 or visit our website at www.shemayisrael.org, where you can find a listing of upcoming special events. Please join us for our weekly Shabbat service. Saturday morning, complete children's program interpretation for the deaf is available. Please notify us in advance if it is needed. Congregation Shema Yisrael also sponsors Bagels and Blessings, a Messianic music and talk radio program with Ethel Chadwick. You can also hear Bagels and Blessings by going to our website, www.shemayisrael.org, or bagelsandblessings.com. Please join us for our Messianic Judaism class, Israeli dance class, Hebrew class, or youth group. Call the office for hours and locations. Tune in next week when Reg A. Yisrael will again bring you teachings from the Scriptures.